So now that you've learned a little bit about statistics, what a null hypothesis is, what a p-value is, what a chi-square test is, let's jump back to the Hardy-Weinberg problem that we were looking at and use those statistical tools in order to determine, is that population of snails in a Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium? So let's take a look. Our next step, or let me pause, where we left off was that we determined what the expected number of snails were of our three different genotypes using that Hardy-Weinberg principle of equilibrium equation. Just as a recap, the observed or the number of snails given to us in the problem were 4 big R big R, 6 big R little r, and 1 little r little r. When we use the Hardy-Weinberg equation to determine the genotype frequencies, we then converted those back to snails, and Hardy-Weinberg said, well, we should have 4.5, 5.06, and 1.43 snails of each of those genotypes. So our next step is just plugging in our observed and our expected values into our chi-square equation. Now, you guys can do this on your own. I am going to work out this problem just so that you guys are kind of following and, I guess, doing the same math, so to speak, as what I'm doing. So I'm going to go ahead and open up my notepad so that we can kind of do this problem together. But in the end, it's quite a simple equation. The biggest thing is just making sure you're putting numbers in the right space and so that you're not accidentally putting in the wrong number, forgetting to square it. The most errors I usually see are just small little errors, not actual mathematical errors. So let's take a look. So you guys don't see it on your screen, but I have the numbers kind of hidden on another screen. And we're going to draw our draw out these equations. So we're going to start a new one. We're going to use white. So as a recap, chi square equals the sum of our observed minus expected squared over expected. So we're going to do this equation 3 times because we have 3 different sets of observed and expected values. So I'm going to write this to the side. You wouldn't have to do this to show your work, but I'm going to make it a little bit more obvious. So we're going to look at the homozygous dominant genotype, and we're going to put in observed. So our observed value is 4 minus our expected, which is 4.51. That's going to be squared divided by our expected. Our heterozygotes is going to be 6 minus 5.06 squared over 5.06. And our homozygotes are 1 minus 1.43 squared over 1.43. Now you can do each of these. So this personally is how I do set this up. I've noticed that some students are like, oh, I've got a graphing calculator and I can do like all of this into one line. But if you mess up just one parenthesis, you can mess up your entire equation. So I personally recommend doing it step by step just to ensure that you're not messing up your math along the way. So I'm going to go ahead and do this first one. So 4 minus 4.51. Beautiful. Then I will square it. So I'm actually doing each of these steps individually in my calculator. So again, that was 4 minus 4.51. Then I square. And then I divide by 4.51. And I'm going to get 0.058. You can keep as many decimal places as you want. You do not need more than 3. I'm doing 3 here just because it's a pretty small number. I'm going to go to the next one, 6 minus 5.06, then I square it, then I divide by 5.06, that equals 0.175, and then lastly 1 minus 1.43 squared, divide by 1.43, gives me 0.129. So what you just solved was this part of the equation. You did the observed minus expected squared divided by expected, but we still have another part of the equation, which is sigma. We still need to add all of our values together. So we're going to add each of these terms together, and what we get is 0.058 plus 0.175 plus 0.129. So I get 0.362. This is my chi-square value, because remember the equation is chi-square equals this series. Now again, you might be tempted to be like, oh, let me take the square root, but don't. We're specifically solving for chi-square. Our problem ends here. So you should have gotten a value of chi-square equals 0.362. So let's go ahead and take a look back at this and start actually interpreting this. So we've plugged it into chi-square. We found, this is off by a decimal. So you're going to see the answer is the same. So this says chi-square equals 0.036. We're going to see even if it is off by a decimal, it actually is not going to affect this. So we have our chi-square value. So next thing we need to do is figure out the corresponding p-value. Remember, chi-square, we can't really evaluate. What we need is that p-value. What's the percent likelihood that our null hypothesis is correct? So here's that statistics table again. Remember, df means degrees of freedom, which is number of variables minus 1. We have two variables, p and q. Minus 1 means there's 1 degree of freedom. And again, no matter which number, again, this error or the 0.362 that we came up with, both of those numbers are found here. 0.3 and 0.03 are found on this side of 0.455. It's a really small number. Now, we don't have the exact p-value, but what we do know is that p must be greater than 0.5. There is a larger than 50% chance that our null hypothesis is correct. I'm going to pause real quick. This particular problem had a really small chi-square value, but you might encounter chi-square problems that have a chi-square in the hundreds, and that is still correct. So sometimes people will see that and be like, oh, chi-square is 150, like that must be wrong. It's great that you're recognizing that it's outside of the norm, but it's not impossible. Chi-square can technically go to infinity. Most of the time we don't see that, but it is possible. So finally, we know our p-value is greater than 0.5, therefore we accept, or maybe the better language, fail to reject our null hypothesis. And that's great, right? We have evaluated our null hypothesis, but bring this back to the science. Bring this back to the question. Okay, you accept our null. So what's happening with these snails? And so be sure that not only do you evaluate your null, be sure to actually talk about what is happening in the science. What is happening in the ecosystem? In this case, nothing is happening. This population is in equilibrium. None of those assumptions. So natural selection isn't broken. So natural selection is not happening. Random mating must be happening. This must be a sufficiently large population. There must be no gene flow. So all of those assumptions that we say a population is for being in equilibrium, none of them are broken. So we actually know a lot about this population based on the fact that we accept our null hypothesis. So that is it. That is one Hardy-Weinberg problem. Now, it seems like a lot because we kind of paused along the way and I did different demos, but in reality, one of these problems may take you 5 to 10 minutes from start to finish. The outline we went through today is how you should tackle all of your Hardy-Weinberg problems. So if you haven't been filling in that worksheet as we were going, I encourage you to go back to that worksheet and fill it out in order to kind of have a really nice guide to help you with future Hardy-Weinberg problems. So again, the point of that math, the point of that statistics, was a way for us to measure evolution. And the way we measure it is using this idea of, well, if a population isn't evolving, if a population isn't changing, it should fit in that Hardy-Weinberg principle of equilibrium. We did that different math and statistics to essentially say, like, hey, did our population fit that model or didn't it? So that's why we were doing this, and it can give us insights as to what might be happening with our populations.